just a couple quick things. First, thanks to everybody for coming here. It's great when we can put so many brilliant minds in a room and you know, jam and come up with different concepts. That's really what Polychain's all about, is this cross-pollination between our portfolio projects. We think that this is really where truly outlier value will be unlocked. One of our key postulates as a firm is to see the future first. And we've been fortunate enough to be able to work with so many brilliant technologists around the space that we're able to start to connect the dots that really WebAssembly VMs is where it appears that the future is going in this space. And so whether it's TrueBit or Definity or Polkadot Web3, now Filecoin Protocol Labs and some other projects looking towards a WASM VM or being able to translate or compile them to a WASM VM. We see this as a clear trend and we're really excited about it. In fact, we're so excited about it that we intend to make specific deployments in WASM related technologies over the next year or potentially two. And so we're really excited to continue to support this area. And we recognize that there is kind of a gap in the amount of talent in this area. So I think one of the interesting trends that we see when some of these protocols go live, like Polkadot and Definity that have governance baked into at the protocol layer, is we see tremendous rewards for technical talent who have this specific skill set with WASM VMs. These governance systems will allow for true outlier payments to be made for for technical talent in the space, and we're going to see some incredible opportunities for people who are willing to put in the time and get up the curve on this technology. So I will turn this over to Sina, because today is more about diving into the deep into the weeds. But if you guys are if you have an idea in the space and you just want to jam and exchange ideas with us, or if you're looking to get involved in a project, please reach out. You can also send an email to careers@polychain.capital. You can send an email to me or email to Robbie, and we'd love to talk. So thanks.
So thanks for joining us here. There's a lot of familiar faces out here, a lot of good friends from back in the day and more recently. So I'm really excited to kind of tell you about TrueBit and what we're doing with WebAssembly. So I thought the way we would structure this, we've had different kinds of conversations with different people in this room. Some of you know how TrueBit works. Some of you know more about how the WebAssembly portion of TrueBit works. So I thought just to kind of give the context, I would talk about what TrueBit is and what we're actually doing as a protocol first. And then I would talk about, kind of shift gears and talk about how WebAssembly is being used in blockchains, because as Robbie said last week or 2 weeks ago, we were at this WebAssembly community group with Definity, and leading up to that, we kind of talked with a bunch of the different projects in this space using WASM. And then after, at the end of all that, I'll talk about how we're using WebAssembly and TrueBit and kind of talk through the entire process. And really, really curious to hear your feedback and thoughts. So let's get into TrueBit. So TrueBit is, first, I think the best way to start these kind of conversations is to talk about the why. Like, what is the problem that we're actually trying to solve? And if you think about how a blockchain works, basically, you write some code in Solidity or Viper or whatever the higher level language is, compile it to bytecode, push it to the blockchain, at which point it's stored by all the nodes in the network. And then from then on, when you send a transaction to that address, you trigger that piece of code to run. And all of the nodes or all of the miners on this network execute that piece of code, not necessarily at the same time. You know, there's usually a leader election mechanism, but eventually one of the miners runs it and then all the other miners, and they come to consensus on, you know, the state transitions that these, you know, code executions result in. And that process, by definition, has a lot of redundancy built in. Every miner is replicating all the work. And when you're running some computation on the network, you're kind of using this shared resource. So because of that, computation is metered on all blockchains. So in Ethereum, there's this concept of gas, where you pay per like instruction in your bytecode, or per byte of memory that your program kind of allocates. So computation is expensive because of that. And the second point is that computation is actually completely bounded as well. So regardless of the fees, even if you're willing to say pay $100 to run, you know, a giant piece of computation, you still wouldn't be able to do that because of the block gas limit. And this is a fundamental property of blockchains, and it ties into the verifier's dilemma. So what this is that, you know, the first miner who creates the block collects all the fees that were provided for that, for the transactions. Now, all the rest of the miners who receive this block need to validate it first before they start building on top of it. And in a proof of work system, you know, the more intensive that validation and like running those computations is, the further behind this person's falling in the race for creating the next block. So as you increase the size of the computation, even though the first miner is getting compensated, everyone else starts having this dilemma where at one point they're like, okay, I'm just gonna skip verification and just jump to creating the next block. And this will result in, you know, all these like micro forks and instability in the network. So this is why the block gas limit exists. And altogether, this means that computation is expensive, it's bounded, and, you know, all these things that we think about when we think about decentralized networks, blockchains, like DAOs, prediction markets, you know, loan, you know, automated loan lending platforms, they all require running computation on chain. And if you're bounded to like, you know, simple business logic, you can't build any of these things. So that's the problem. And that's the problem that Trubit is solving. So how do we do that? Trubit is a crypto-economic protocol for running computation off-chain and verifying that the results of it are correct. So I'm just gonna talk you through the protocol and use diagrams. I kind of took them from this blog post that we had about a month ago. So, you know, this, you know, any computation that's run on the blockchain is generally triggered by a user. So this is the user on the left running the computation on a dApp contract. And, you know, you can imagine in the simple case, let's say this dApp is a DAO that's trying to iterate, you know, through a series of votes and calculate the results, and it can't do that on chain because there's too many votes in this list. It just runs out of gas. So instead of running that computation itself, it makes this call to the Trubit contract, and it creates a task. So the Trubit contract is a smart contract deployed on Ethereum or any of the other blockchains. And what is the dApp actually providing? It provides three pieces of information, and like we'll dig into this more deeply later. But basically the first point is the program itself, which is the function that's doing the work. You know, so in the case of this DAO voting thing, it's something that takes an array of votes and tallies up the results. It's that function. The inputs are, you know, in this case, it would be the actual array of votes, what you want to feed through this program. And this is basically the entire thing, right? The program and the inputs. And you provide some amount of reward, which is like ETH for someone to solve this computation. Now this task gets created, and now in the Trubit contract, there's a new task. And there's a network of Trubit miners who are, you know, anyone, it's a free entry system, people can install the client on their computer, and they're listening for tasks on this contract. And they see a new task get created, and if they want to solve it for the reward, they basically go ahead, download the code, started with the inputs, like boot up their Wasm VM, because all the code is Wasm bytecode, run it to the end, get the solution, and post the solution. So someone, whoever does this first, becomes the solver. and they submit a solution, and they also include a deposit of their own money. So that now they have like skin in the game behind the solution that they claimed. So it's a crypto economic protocol, and we'll get to how. So now this person submitted a solution. And basically a timeout starts ticking on this Truebit contract. And this is a challenge timeout, and where anyone else can basically challenge the solution. In the happy path, where no one, you know, challenges this thing, some amount of time passes, and no challenges come in, so the Truebit contract calls back to the DApp, being like resolve, you know, task resolved, and it passes in the result. So in these cases where no one challenges it, basically one person ran the computation and you got the result back. In the more interesting case where there's a challenge, someone submits a challenge, and so they saw the solution come in, they're like, I disagree with this answer. They submit a challenge and they include their own deposit. So this person also has skin in the game. So now from the point of view of the contract, there's a solution, a challenge, and two deposits. Now it needs to resolve this dispute. And how it does this is through an interactive verification game. So the challenger, this person on the left, is responsible for forcing this game forward, and they actually take the first turn. So the challenger uses kind of an interesting trick. They know that, you know, if the program is a WASM module, and you can think of these things as like a series of instructions that are executed one after another. And let's say in this like simple example, this WASM function had 14 instructions, or, you know, 15 instructions. Zero indexed. So there's 15 instructions in the WASM module. And the challenger knows that both them and the solver agreed at the very beginning, because they had the same program, they had the same inputs, and they had the same MTVM, right? So everything was the same at the genesis. And then they ran through all the instructions, and after step 14, they disagreed because they got different answers. And so, yeah, just to clarify, these are WebAssembly modules that we're talking about. So this is, you know, on the left is some C++ code, and on the right is the WASM text format when you like compile it to WASM. And so the challenger knows this and uses this knowledge and basically queries. So they're like, there's 15 steps, we agree at the beginning, we disagree at the end. So I'm gonna ask the solver what their state was at the halfway point. So after instruction 7, what was the solver's VM state? So the challenger goes first, and they send a query call to the smart contract passing in the step. So this would say 7. Now after that, it's the solver's turn. So it's an interactive game. The solver responds with their hash, their state hash at that step. And their state hash is basically summing up, it's representing what their entire state was at that point. So again, we'll get into this later, but basically imagine all the parts of the WebAssembly VM, like the memory, the stack, the registers, all the information is basically put into a Merkle tree, which is, you know, a binary tree where every node that you go up is a hash of the two items underneath it. And the solver puts all their state in there and gets the root and submits the root to the contract. So at this point, it's again the challenger's turn. The challenger now has the root of the solver at step 7. They calculate their own root and they compare the two values. So if these two values are the same, which they are in this case, given by the green, it basically means that they agreed on everything from the beginning up to the midway point. Because, you know, it's very like, they wouldn't have agreed on everything. So at this point, the challenger can deduce that the disagreement occurred like in the second half of the computation. If the two state roots were different, so if 7 was red here, the challenger would have deduced that the disagreement happened in the first half of the computation. So with that knowledge, the challenger now queries for the midpoint of one of these two segments. So they query for the midpoint at step 10. The solver responds, the challenger sees that they agree again, so they query for the midpoint of the right half. The solver responds, they agree, challenger queries again, solve a response, and they see that they disagree there. So basically, if you project this game to the end, which happened here, the challenger every time, by querying the midpoints of one of these sides, splits the possible set of like instructions where the discrepancy occurred in half. And so it's a binary search, effectively, every time it's halved. So with log n time, with n being the number of instructions, the challenger narrows down the scope of the problem to the point where it gets to one instruction. So in this particular case, they know that they agreed at state 12. They disagreed with the solver at state 13. So that transition, the single instruction that went from like 12 to 13 is the dispute.
So why do I care about these instructions, not just the final answer? Why do I want to find where we disagree?
That's the dispute resolution mechanism.
Got it.
Yeah. So you know, so the challenger deduces that this tiny piece was like the first place that these two people, that they disagreed with the solver. And this is now the interesting part. So now the computation is small enough that we run this single disputed instruction on chain. So we have a WebAssembly interpreter written in Solidity on the EVM that we initialize to this state, and we run the one instruction and get the result and compare it with what the solver said. And if it's different from what the solver said, the solver gets slashed. They lose their deposit. So what does this give us? Basically, in cases where there are no challenges, so in the expected case where the solver told the truth, basically there's no challenges, you get the solution back to the DAP immediately once the timeout runs out. In cases where there's a challenge, you only have to run one instruction on chain. So this means that, you know, you can run anything beyond the gas limit, outside of like the expensive cost of gas on Ethereum and on any blockchain. And then so we have this like term that we use also, that we have a unanimous consensus here. So generally, you know, we're achieving consensus on the results of this computation, but what are the properties of this consensus? So in Nakamoto consensus, you know, you need 51% honest majority. In BFT, you need 2/3. In TrueBit, in this system, because we're leveraging the security of the base chain, you actually need only one honest verifier. So it doesn't matter if the solver is telling, like, lying, it doesn't matter if, you know, they're colluding with like 10 challengers. As long as there's one challenger in the entire system who puts in a challenge, they'll get caught. So that's how this works. And so this is a note around like the crypto economics of it. So thought I'd just like mention this, that it's not only like a computer science type of a problem, because if you actually think about the system that we described, it doesn't work as it is. So, you know, the solver knows that they'll get caught if they lie. Like, they'll always get caught if there's one challenger. So they basically never lie. And if the solver never lies, then verifiers never make any money. And if they never make any money, they stop showing up. And if verifiers stop showing up, then the solver can start lying. So that system doesn't have a stable equilibrium. And the way we solve that is through this concept of like forced errors. So the protocol, so how would you get around this? And like, this is the way we do it, is the protocol actually forces the solver to give a wrong answer probabilistically. So let's say, you know, with a probability of 1%, like one out of every 100 tasks, the solver is forced to give a wrong answer. And in those cases, whichever challenger challenges them, they win a jackpot reward, which is like 100 times larger than what they would normally win. So in these cases, you know, if you think about it, like from the point of view of the verifier, even if you know the solvers never lie and you catch that 1 out of 100 wrong solution, because the reward is 100 times larger, your expected profit is actually still positive. So you keep showing up. And that's just a note on the crypto economics. And like, this is the final slide on like how TrueBit works. So basically, this system relies on you know, WebAssembly and the execution of arbitrary code, and it's like a hard problem. That's why we're like thinking through what the architecture is. But we actually built like a simplified version of it called like TrueBit Lite, which instead of running any program, it just runs the Scrypt hashing function, and this was needed by the Doge Ethereum bridge. So we actually built this, and it's like on testnet, and it works. And so we know that, like, you know, the challenge response mechanism, the binary search, like, that stuff works. Now we need to kind of extend it to WebAssembly.
Isn't there, like, a limit on, sorry, is it okay to ask questions?
Yeah, because this is, like, a natural kind of transition, so okay. You can go ahead.
Isn't there a limit on, like, how much state you can pass in to, like, a smart contract on Ethereum, like the size of parameters? Because you have to pass in the whole, like, state of the VM, right?
Not the entire state of the VM, so we'll talk about that a little bit. But you can actually be selective about it. Because if you know what instruction is getting executed, each instruction will only touch, like, certain portions of the state. So if you have, like, you know, an add, you just need the top two items in the stack. You don't care about the memory or anything like that. Yeah?
So if I understand correctly, like, the motivation is trying to save gas by using true bit, right? But your true bit solidity code actually has the whole, like, WebAssembly interpreter and all that running. So at what point, is it actually more cost-effective to use TrueBit versus just run it on-chain?
Yeah, so the WebAssembly code, it, like the interpreter on-chain, is only ever running one instruction, right? And so instructions are really simple. It's like take something from the stack, like add two numbers, read something from the memory. What's complicated is running the entire program. So by narrowing it down, you're actually like reducing the cost by a lot. The part that could cost a lot is this like back and forth, right? Because you have log n, you know, transactions that need to happen. So those transactions are generally paid for by the person who loses the verification game, because both the solver and the challenger put their deposits in, and when the verification game ends, you just take all the gas costs out of like the losers. You pay back the solver.
How do you force the error for the jackpot purpose?
Yeah, so basically, it's been a while since we developed this like a few months ago, and I haven't looked at it in a while. But the basic idea is that the solver actually at any time submits two solutions. So for every task, the solver is required to submit two solutions. One of them is the correct answer, one of them is the wrong answer. And then they also commit to a random number of their own choice. And then after both solutions are submitted, they take the next block hash and hash it with the random number that they chose. And given the results of that, they have to basically like either pick the correct solution or the wrong solution. And then at the next step, they reveal the random number, so the truth comes out, like whether there was a forced error or not. That's the general mechanism. Like it's a commit reveal type of a thing, which uses the randomness of the next block hash.
If the challenger and what were the name of the two parties?
The solver and the
solver,
challenger.
Solver and challenger. The solver knows what the correct answer was. So at the point that the challenger is given the challenge, the solver knows whether this is one of the jackpot cases or not. Couldn't a solver and challenger in collusion, the solver tells the challenger this is one of those jackpot cases, let's collect the jackpot?
So you're hitting on one of the good points here. So I simplified the mechanism. And it's actually expected that if the solver knows that there's a jackpot, they would actually spin up Sybil identities themselves and challenge the solution. So we had to come up with a mechanism to prevent the solver from Sybiling the jackpot when they know there's a forced error. And how we did that, which is kind of like being reassessed right now, is through this exponential drop-off. So the jackpot that's paid out to each challenger is scales or falls exponentially with the number of challengers. So if you're the solver and you have this piece of information, because you know that if another challenger shows up, your reward will fall by like 1/2 to the n, you actually don't share that with anyone and you don't challenge yourself. You challenge once, basically. And So it's kind of funny to talk about this because Zach and like Dandelion, like these are people who we've talked about a lot about this exponential drop off. And it's kind of like we're kind of reassessing whether an exponential drop off is the right function to use. It's definitely the right function to use if you're thinking about one game. But if you extrapolate to multiple games, then someone can you know, take away the profits for other challenges over time. So this is kind of an ongoing area of like research on the crypto economic side.
Maybe we should go against the WebAssembly stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So WebAssembly and blockchains. So So WebAssembly is basically like being used, like Ryan said, by a ton of projects in the space. So we've been talking to, you know, people at, like Martin from Definity, Polkadot, Ethereum, and us last week with at the WebAssembly community group, which, you know, Mark and Dan were at. And, you know, WebAssembly makes a lot of sense because it's portable, so it runs on all different kinds of operating systems and hardware architectures. It's efficient, it's secure, it's a compilation target for all these multiple languages. And you know, it has the resources of companies like Google, Apple, Mozilla, and Microsoft behind it. So it makes a lot of sense. And so what are, like, when you move from using WebAssembly in the web to using it in blockchains, you need to like fix a couple of things. One is this concept of metering, which is instead of when you're running in blockchains, people now need to pay per instruction or like byte of memory that they're using. And how do you actually do this? So, you know, the EVM has this concept of gas, and we basically introduced a similar concept in WebAssembly. So the mechanic of it, like, I think, you know, we can dig into the details if we want, but basically this process finds like all blocks of code in the WASM code. So, you know, when you enter an if statement, all these instructions will execute, either all of them will execute as an atomic unit or none of them will. So you tally up the cost of each of those instructions, and you just insert one instruction at the very top that just appends that to the total cost of gas that your program has used. So if you enter this like block, you basically count this thing towards your gas. And if this total number goes above your gas limit, you just throw. So that's the mechanism there. And the other thing that we all need to do is deal with non-determinism. Because in blockchains, all these nodes and computers need to come to agreement on the results. So if anything causes different computers to get different results, that's bad. It's going to break consensus. So two places that that happens, one are like resource limits. And this is, you know, when you run on different computers, they have different amounts of memory. And so you need to protect against that. You need to like explicitly set limits or account for it with gas. And the other thing is like floating point. And this resolves differently on different like hardware architectures. So one thing that most of these projects are doing is when you give a WASM module to the system, if there's any floating point operations or values in there, it just rejects the bytecode. And it's like, you can't use this in the system. So, all right, WebAssembly and TrueBit.
So what about like loop unrolling and stack depth and all that? How do you handle that in the I don't know WebAssembly at all. But I'm assuming that it's sort of, there is no limit on stack depth and all that stuff because it's an unconstrained environment. But considering what we're talking about here, you probably need that.
Yeah, so you do need, that's another one of those resource limits. You need to actually put a limit on the call stack.
But what if you can't calculate what that's going to be? Is it just...
You do it kind of dynamically by using gas. Mm-hmm. And so Martin's like kind of been in this WASM world for longer, so I think he'll be able to answer some of your deeper questions, but... I think it's a really interesting thing, and like actually one thing I wanted to say here is that the reason why we're trying to build this community is that, you know, all of this stuff is open source. We're working together, so there's some people in this room who are way deeper experts here. So if you have any feedback or if you think any parts of the system don't make sense or could be improved, like definitely come and talk to me. So how we're using it in TrueBit. So just to refresh memory, so TaskGiver submits the task, which included a program and the inputs. So the first question is, how do you determine the reward? So the TaskGiver had to attach some amount of reward to this task, right? And so the solver only solves tasks if the reward kind of makes sense. And how do you do this given that, you know, the task giver could lie about how many instructions there are, and you basically need a similar system to Ethereum where you need to price per instruction and then give like a total cost. So you have an analogous concept of gas price and gas limit. Gas price being, you know, the units of, you know, the cost of each opcode, and the gas limit being the total amount of like gas, or like the total amount of reward that this person is attaching, how many opcodes that will carry through. So, you know, thinking back to how we've done metering in blockchains by inserting these metering instructions into the bytecode, could we, and this task giver is providing the module to the system, could we ask the task giver to put in the metering instructions themselves before they submit the bytecode? And I think the answer here is that no, you can't, because the task giver could be lying, obviously. And if they, you know, put bogus metering instructions, there's no way to check them. That's kind of the first point. The next point that TrueBit needs to deal with is the initialization of the VM. So when you take a WASM module, is kind of this like static file, and before you execute it, you need to actually instantiate the module. And this means that you actually load things into the memory, into the globals, into the call tables, which is where the functions are. And this process itself is kind of non-deterministic, because, you know, it doesn't actually affect how the program executes. But if you're comparing on a state, you know, step-by-step basis between these different clients, you need to actually fix this in place. So how could we get around this? Like, a simple way would be that the task giver themselves instantiates the module and then gives like a state root of the module, of the instantiated module. So, you know, they give the hash of the actual bytecode, but they also take the extra step of loading the bytecode into the VM and calculating a state of that after that and supplying that as a task. But that's kind of like a horrible UX. Like, you're relying on these task givers to boot up a VM and, you know, put this data in there and then provide a value. So that's kind of like off the table as well. So how do we actually do this? So the information that the task giver needs to provide is the hash of the WASM module with no metering instructions, the hash of the inputs, the gas price, and the gas limit. So the gas limit being like the total number of gas that they want to provide. Now you would get to execution of a TrueBit task. So the solver looks at the gas price and the total gas, it's like, yes, I'm willing to do this work for the reward. Now they want to actually execute it. So what do? They download the code and the outputs. The next thing they do is they themselves take the bytecode and go through that process of inserting the metering instructions into it. So now there's like bytecode with the metering instructions in it. The next thing they do is they take that module and they instantiate it. So now it's like a live instance that can be executed. After that, they run through all the instructions, so actually execute the code, and they get the solution and submit it to the contract. So the TrueBit system that we talked about, it really only talked about step 4, which is like you're running these instructions one after another, and that's like the challenge, the verification game that we had only applies to that. But how do you deal, like, the process of like metering the code or instantiating a module? Like, what if there's a disagreement in how that happens? Like, a challenger was like, no, this is wrong. So the idea we have there, which we're working on, is to actually implement, so this is step 2 and 3. So the metering and the instantiation themselves are implemented as WASM modules. So the code that takes the module and adds the stuff to it will be written in Rust or something, compiles to WASM, and then if there's a disagreement, you actually run a verification game on that specific task. So a challenger could be like, I disagree with the metering, and you run the metering task on that bytecode.
Oh.
So that's kind of one of the interesting ideas, which we can kind of like add to the system with WASM modules. Now the other kind of point in TrueBit is that, you know, some tasks, like they receive the input. Some simple tasks could receive the input directly. So in the case of this Scrypt hash, you actually provide all the fields that you want to be hashed directly into the function call. So that's simple. But some tasks need to get the data from like the off-chain world. Like LivePeer, which is one of these protocols we're working with, does transcoding of video. It's a peer-to-peer video streaming service. So they want to use TrueBit to check that these transcoders are doing their job correctly. So basically, the task is FFprobe, which is, or FFmpeg in its final, you know, when things are like done, which is a, you know, program that transcodes video. And the inputs to it are a segment of video. So you can't like include a segment of video in a Solidity call. So instead what you do is you include, you know, the IPFS hash of where this segment could be found, or like another content address location of this data. So then the other thing is that the TrueBit file system, so-called, will have to have this ability. So there's different ways to implement this. But basically, this WASM VM that's sitting there needs to have the ability to read files from the external world that that could normally be a cause for indeterminism. But because the roots of these files were provided as the input, and all of these schemes that we use in the centralized world are, you know, cryptographic, you can actually check that the data that was loaded in was linked to the roots with a Merkle, with a, you know, through a Merkle tree. So this functionality also needs to exist in the TrueBit system, and we have like a prototype of it. Now we get to like kind of an unsolved problem, which is data availability. So this exists, you know, multiple places in the blockchain world, and anytime you have an off-chain protocol, this becomes an issue. So the question is, you know, in our case, the task giver said that, okay, this is the IPFS hash of where the data is. What if it's not there? That case is okay. What about if the solver submits a solution, now it's the turn of the verifiers to go and check that answer, but the bytecode is like not even on IPFS anymore. So no one can challenge the solution. So how do you deal with this? And basically you need to build some kind of a network to come to consensus on like file blocks. And there's three candidates we have for this. So Jason, who's TrueBit's founder, had this write-up around, you know, a system that could use Nakamoto consensus for coming to consensus around data. There's the Ethereum sharding research, which, you know, John here probably knows a lot about, but I'm actually spending a little bit of time with them next week to see how this could fit into TrueBit. And the final point is Filecoin, which is, you know, the incentive layer overlaying IPFS to kind of give you guarantees around the data being publicly available. But this is kind of one of those pieces that needs to be in effect for TrueBit to fully function. Another question that comes up, and there's only like three slides left, so it's close to the end, is the speed of execution. So we're running this in WASM module beginning to end. The first run, when the solver is running it, you can run it with just-in-time compilation, which is fast. And in most cases, you expect the solver gives the answer, and because they didn't lie, there's no challenges. So you actually run very efficiently. In cases where you need these snapshots, then you use an interpreter, which is going through instruction by instruction and, you know, creating the real stack and taking snapshots of it. So that process itself is relatively slow, but will only happen in case of like verification. And so what are inside these state snapshots? So this is, you know, a list of like basically all the parts of a WASM VM. So the memory, the call table, the stack pointer, the program counter, basically all of these things are placed into a Merkle tree and the root of it is taken. And so the point there is that except the code and the inputs, which are here, so I kind of simplified the picture a little. You need like a few more pieces of information in the beginning. But basically, other than those, everything else is like empty when you first create a task. And I think this is the last slide, but so will one WASM instruction actually fit on chain? Like even though we've narrowed it down to one step, what about that one step? You know, what if it's loading memory, or you know, it's doing some crazy thing? So to get around this, basically TrueBit further divides each instruction into multiple phases. And what are phases? So think of think of the add opcode. What is that doing? First, you know, you have the stage root, and you, what do you need to do? First, you need to get the instruction, which is add. Then you need to get the top item from the stack. Then you need to get the next item from the stack. Then you need to add them together. Then you need to push it onto the stack. So there's five or six things that happen there. And each of these is one phase of this opcode. And so in the final step, it's actually a simplification to say that the solver only provides a root. They actually provide, once they get to that final step, they actually provide roots after every phase of that opcode. So they'll provide like five or six roots. And that's what the challenger sees, goes through and picks one of those phases as the challenge. And then that's what actually runs on chain. So it's actually a tiny, tiny bit of work. And basically all WASM phases, like there's actually a few phases that opcodes are composed of, because you know it's reading from the stack, reading from the memory, that a lot of things reuse. And all of those things fit within the Ethereum gas limit. And this is where you can find some of the TrueBit WASM code. So the top thing is our wiki, which is most of the write-ups. Then WebAssembly Solidity is the interpreter on-chain, and OCaml off-chain is a fork of the spec reference interpreter in OCaml. And yeah, like I said, we're a pretty small team. It's six of us, and you know we're working through the architecture of this VM. So if any of you guys want to like kind of contribute in that process, we'd very much welcome that. And, yeah.
Do like a 5 minute break and we'll get Martin set up.
Yeah,
okay,
and like
I can put questions on pause for now, and afterwards
yeah.
Anyone wants to stick around.
Like
questions.
If you just shoot me an email, or you know, we can talk after at some point.